And welcome to the Lync 2013 Ignite, Lync Updates and Programs, Lync Enterprise Voice Core Infrastructure Updates course. All right. Today with me, I have Aaron Steele.
Hi, Brian.
And I'm Brian. Aaron, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself?
So I'm a senior consultant with Microsoft. I've been with Microsoft for about 3 years. I've been focused specifically on Lync and Enterprise Voice. I've been in computers for, 18 or more years. I came from higher education. I live in Chicago. I have two wonderful kids and a pastry chef for a wife. Aren't y'all jealous?
Nice. And I'm Brian Ricks. I own my own company. I'm an independent consultant. Company name is Brightcomp Computers. We focus on infrastructure in general, from networking to Active Directory to Lync. And that's where we're at. So I have been working with the Lync product since the LCS days, since 2003, and been an MVP with, at the time, it was Communication Server, since 2006. I'm also a Microsoft Certified Master's Communications, 2013, and have been doing various IT things for the past 20 years, but been independent and gone down this fun path since 2009. From setting expectations perspective, the target audience, that would be you, we are expecting to know Lync 2013. This is not teaching Lync 2013 as much as it's refreshing what has changed since the release to manufacturing or RTM. So we are looking to give you updates and information and perhaps some insight of things you didn't know that are in the new versions from the cumulative update perspective. There are some courses that you can go ahead and take, the Microsoft courses from 336 and 337, there we go, that are available online, and you can go here to start to look at them and then get more information. And then from there, you can go to a CPLS and actually take the course if you'd like. We have a link from where you can go find a class or and somebody that provides it. There's also a couple of exams that relate to Lync in general, the 336 and 337, and of course, there is an MCSC specifically for Lync. So, in this particular course, we are going to talk about the voice architecture in general. It's just an overview of what is and how it works, how routing works, and again, some of this is a refresher, basics of how it works, and that's really to lead into the newer feature of location-based routing and how we get the ability to decide if calls are going to go out particular gateways or not based on settings that we've done. Also, as a sort of reminder, we are M2N routing or many-to-many, so we can have a mediation server talk to the same PST gateway as another mediation server within your mix, something that natively, something we couldn't easily do in 2010.
Right.
And then session management, which is a 2013 feature, but is the concept that allows us to put Lync in front of whatever and be in any place and location within a voice architecture, allowing it to route calls in and out. It doesn't have to be bound for Lync anymore, like we were in 2010.
Right.
But again, a 2013 thing.
Exactly. In 2010, we were really bound from this idea of that Lync couldn't take a call in over one trunk and transfer it out across a different trunk. It had
the end there, right?
It had to terminate in Lync rather than being terminated somewhere outside of it.
It's kind of almost like an authoritative kind of thing where it stopped there. There was nowhere else to go. If it wasn't in Lync and it got to Lync, it died. We no longer have that in 2013. Okay, so the voice architecture overview. So at a very high level, we have a nice, pretty eye chart for you to look at the high-level topology.
And you'll notice... I don't even think this is that much of an eye chart, Brian.
This one's not as bad as it can get. When we get the full, blown-out diagram that shows how Lync communicates, that can be more of an eye chart. But when we look here, we see a lot hasn't changed from 2013 to our current cumulative updates. The biggest thing that you'll notice is that on the Edge server itself, and let me click on here, The pool and the edge servers and how the mediation works, that's really what's changed. And then we have, of course, Skype and Office 365 showing up and saying, yay, now we have Office 365 and Skype that is listed as being publicly available to ourselves. On the PSTN and PBX, we can see that we have this little dotted lines of things that are coming to and from because we've broken out mediation. And we also see that the PBX is tied directly to a mediation server. It's also tied directly to the cloud, to a PSTN ITSP. Beyond that, That's what we got.
Right. It's a very similar technology or very similar deployment that you would have seen in Lync 2010 and Lync 2013. We've added some new capabilities and some new connections on that outside layer.
From a voice enhancement perspective, we break this down into three different things. And again, this isn't necessarily all post-RTM. Some of this is cumulative updates, some of it's RTM. But from a routing enhancements perspective, we have the support for multiple to many. The M2N concept of a mediation server can talk to multiple gateways and vice versa, and you can get a whole web of communications if you wanted. And session management, which was the big one, and location-based routing. Those three are the new enhancements that are new to 2013 post-RTM. Then we have what we had before, which was IPv6 and VDI. And we say IPv6 for all Lync communications, and that should really be all, almost, because we have some things that are IPv4 dependent, most namely our location-based stuff. And then VDI support. VDI was a big change and enhancement in 2013, which allowed us to take audio from the from the client itself and bypass having to go to the server and go direct so we could have VDI.
Sure. It's similar to, in Lync, you might have seen media bypass. It's sort of similar in a theory to to media bypass in that way.
Our deployment types are still the same. We haven't made any changes there. Of course, we can do on-premise. We can do dedicated. The private cloud concept has been more common recently as we've been going through deployments where companies have off-site data centers. They don't actually have servers on site. So conceptually, it's a cloud because it's not directly on-premise, but it's a high-speed WAN. But they still own the servers. They own the racks. They own it, the connections. There is the option to be hybrid. Hybrid allows us to be some of our people in the cloud, some of our people on-premise, all managed on-premise, and it is the central source of authority. And then we have complete cloud.
So in the hybrid model, can we share the consumption of services across those? So if I'm homed in the cloud, do I get to consume services from the on-prem environment?
They're separate. We consume the authentication model. Beyond that, it's really no.
Right.
We do have the ability, however, to have the cloud, and I don't know if it's so much as kind of sold this way, but to have people in the cloud that are having large conferences or conferences in addition to their on-premise conferences that are kind of moved off of their on-premise and put in the cloud, as long as it starts with an on-cloud, with
sure,
a person
sure.
in the cloud.
And that's sort of similar to that large presence or large conference meeting, large meeting support.
Exactly.
It's this idea that you would have a dedicated scheduler who would live in the cloud to offload those conferences into the cloud that you don't want to home on-prem.
Exactly. So the enabling of the migration is the true story that Microsoft has of the hybrid model. It's the concept that, hey, maybe we want to be in the cloud, maybe we don't. Let's move some of our people up and try it.
Yep.
And if we don't like it, we'll move it back and nothing lost. And so it's really the only story out there of cloud and on-prem and a slow migration or no migration if that in case is what you want. Okay. From an overview of what it is, what you get, what you don't get, there are, of course, some trade-offs to when you decide to go to cloud versus not. On-premise, the big differentiator we have for on-premise is full enterprise voice. All the functionality, all the bells and whistles, everything exists when you're on-premise.
And persistent chat.
And
we are talking about that here.
Yeah, we don't. But there is pchat as well. With online, you get IM presence meetings, you get voice over IP, you get video over IP. What you don't get is enterprise voice. And again, enterprise voice, we mean PSTN access. You don't have that dial-out, dial-in options.
Right. You have to add a third party to add the dial-in conferencing into your cloud offering.
Yeah. Same concept as a traditional conferencing bridge service.
Yep.
And you can add that in. From a hybrid perspective, you get full enterprise voice as long as you are on-premise. If you are in the cloud, those kind of features go away. You are sharing a common GAL, so you have the same roster of people. Everything looks the same. A common namespace. Much like where Exchange was at a few years ago, be able to share a namespace, now we have the same capability within Lync Online in a hybrid mode. And then hosted, of course, is the ability to go to somebody else and have your services there. That can depend. If they're using the hosting pack, you're going to get some features different than on-premise. If they're on-premise, in theory, you could have everything. And it's just like having your cloud-based personal deployment.
Yep, and these sort of work when you're thinking about it, that third party hosting is where you get some of the flexibility when you're integrating with Exchange Online or Exchange Server on-prem or Exchange Server in that same hosting provider.
Right. One thing to comment since we bring it up is that Exchange on-premise can integrate with Exchange on-premise. Exchange on-premise, Lync on-premise can integrate with Exchange Online. Lync Online cannot integrate with Exchange on-premise. We don't go backwards the other way.
Right. The only integration point in that really mode being voicemail.
Yeah.
And since the cloud has no voicemail because it has no PSTN, we don't really drop in voicemail
in
that
mode.
There.
Right. Okay. Now, looking at our voice routing and Lync, what has changed or not changed? Kind of like a recap of how things work and don't work, and from a very technical perspective. So let's get going. Okay. So from a voice routing, if you ever wonder how a call kind of decides where it goes and what happens to that call and what bucket it gets into, this is a great thing to start looking at.
Oh, this is a slide that I've seen many, many, many times and is very useful to understand. One thing that I've noted about this slide in passing is it looks like this is about inbound, but in fact, the same rules apply for inbound calls, just in a different manner.
Kind of flip things around, right? So if a call is initiated externally, and we'll look at an external call, and things route from an inbound routing perspective, things are going to flow inbound. Now, if we go from a user inbound, which is what by default we're looking at, then the user initiates the call. And when they do, the first thing we always look at is it 911? And that's going to be based off of a location profile that you've created that defines what 911 is. A lot of people mistakenly will put in their dial plans, normalization for 911. It should never happen. It should never be caught. It should never be there. And what's going to happen is when you enter 911, because it's in the location profile, the plus is added, it's routed, it's done. Or whatever the number is that you've defined as being your emergency number. The advantage of that is we don't care what your policies are. You'll notice we bypass your voice policy lookups, your routes. We bypass everything. We go right to, okay, based off your location, that means you're going to go out point X and out the call goes. We don't really massage or look at the data. And the reasoning being it's an emergency call. Everybody has the right to make one.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And you can't change that. So that's the way it goes. So if it's not an emergency call, then you'll notice we go to the global lookup and change to see where are things at.
What do you mean global?
Global would be where we have a policy that is a global policy for the dial plans and for the communication that's coming in. We're also looking at things in the sense of, is it already E.164 formatted? If it is, then great, it technically is normalized and ready to go. So if we come into global and we are outbound at E.164 already, then we don't have to go look up to figure out how to turn it to an E.164, right?
Right. Really what we mean at a technical detail about global is, does it start with a plus? It really gets down to, and we sort of treat anything, whether it's short, long, or medium strings of numbers, as long as they start with a plus, we treat those as normalized and don't send them through the dial plan and number normalization.
And that's another key reason why, if you'll notice, the next part of where it goes is the call orbit. If you put your call park orbit in your dial plans and normalize it, it's very possible we're going to miss it again because you have told it to bypass, you've normalized it, and off it goes.
Right, call park probably shouldn't start with a plus.
Probably shouldn't. Star or pound is what our arguments are. So, assuming that it's not a number that has been normalized, then we are going off or start with a plus. Because to Aaron's point, it's not uncommon that we'll have non-DIDs 5,000 range that has start with a plus because that's just what their numbers are. They're normalized, but they're not E.164 truly.
Yeah.
We go and look at the normalization rules on the dial plan based off who you are, of course, and normalize the rule. If it can't normalize, we fall down to, is it a call park number? If it is a call park number, we know where it's going to go. If neither of those match and we have no way to normalize this into a plus number in E.164, then we get a 404. Can't make the call, it dies at that particular time. If it can, then off we go into this reverse number lookup. Can we figure out who this user is internally? Because if we can, then you'll notice we jump straight over to match and dial outbound. It's an internal number, somebody's gonna meet, off it goes.
We sort of treat it as an outbound call at that point, but in fact it sort of becomes a SIP to SIP P2P call across that, you know, link URI to link URI rather than a outbound routing through the PST usages and the routes and the trunks.
Yeah, and it's funny because I had a client just recently, as I was assisting them with some configuration, they were giving instruction to some users and saying, make sure you're not dialing the numbers internally anymore. We want to dial by the user's name because we don't want to use the PST and trunks. When in fact, you can dial an internal number. It will never leave the system if it is our number. It's conceptually, you know, it's like, it is. It's a PBX. We own the number. Because we own the number, we don't send it outbound. It terminates on us.
As long as we normalize it to match a user, you know, that user will receive the call even though you dialed a phone number.
Right. And typically you'll see in your Lync client, if you had and dialed it correctly in the Lync client, it will turn it into both the number or the user because we know it's a user. We actually have been able to normalize that back out. So that's all done initially just by typing in phone numbers. All this logic's happening on the back end. If there is no match to a user internally, we move over here to the no match and we take it down to, is it a vacant number? So maybe it's not assigned to a user, but you've defined it in the vacant number area. And so therefore you own it. We don't want to send it outbound through a trunk. We want to go ahead and do whatever it is we've defined the vacant number range to get. And we'll get a little bit later into that in this deck. Same with the call park. If it is an actual call park, it's going to hit that and it's going to park the call and be able to retrieve it from that particular space. And that's where the announcement or call park plays. From there, we go off to what's your voice policy? Because at this point, we want to see it now. The voice policy and the routes and the PST usage, do you have the right to make this call? And if you do have the right to make the call, which trunk should you be using to make this call? And so off we go to look up the PST usage. And if the PST usage has no route, we get a 403. You would be authorized to make this call, it appears, but you have no way to make this call. If they do have a route, then from the route, we validate that the PST usage and the routes are part of the voice policy. Everything ties together. Assuming you're authorized, off it goes, and we make the call. Now, it is possible that you get a 404 still because it's a bad number you've dialed. But we, as a system, are saying that's a number that can go outbound. You are authorized to make the call. Off it goes.
You may have still called somebody on the outside who doesn't actually have that number anymore.
Exactly.
It may, in fact, come back to us as what we would treat as a 404 or not found. To you, it might come back as a fast busy or something like, you know, no person can be found at that number. The wireless caller you're reaching is unavailable.
Yeah, the wireless caller number, yeah. Those announcements can be very annoying. But yes, the wireless number, and you're like, I'm not even on calling a wireless number. But that's the whole DID, who owns what range thing, and we'll leave that at that. So from the voice routing, if something's not working, a great place to start is to look at this chart and say, where is the call dying? What am I getting a 404? Is it actually making it out? Do I have logic to get this out? And of course, there are other courses that teach the 336, 337 to show how to validate routing, how to do logging and check things and all of that. This is just simply to say nothing's changed. Since yep. RTM, we still route the same way and it's still all conceptually the same. Yay. So, and now we get to see one.
It builds.
To two. And I knew that. To three. To four. And off we go looking down the route. And as you'll notice, it is a logical progression, as you would expect. And assuming that the numbers match, we go with the match. If they don't match, we look to vacant, like we mentioned. And once we get to the policies, we look at the policy to make sure it's valid. Then the route. Okay, that was fun. So now routing and authorization. Now, the idea of routing and authorization, again, hasn't changed, and it's identical to what we had before. Voice policies, as you may or may not recall, are the only thing that's assigned to a user, right? So you have dial plans and voice policies. PST usages and routes are associated to the voice policy, and one is the authorization, and one is how you get out the actual route itself. On the route, it could be valid numbers that can go out the route too. So while you may have the usage tied to the route that can do the way in and out, and off we go. And so this is where the picture shows attempts to show what is and what cannot be done from a concept of routing in general. And flexibility was the whole reason that any of this was done. The idea was you could have a single voice policy with multiple PSTN usages, which could then be tied to multiple routes, and you can reuse things over and over and over. To create a very complex system, if in fact that's what you need to happen.
The flexibility create the complexity that you need to get your business done.
It's key, yes, that's a great way to say it. But it's key to know that complexity for the sake of complexity is a bad idea. And so if we can simplify things from a link routing perspective and a lookup, while it may be milliseconds, it's that much time that's being saved by the system processing what can we and can we not do from this routing perspective.
Yeah, creating routes or creating PSTN usages just to have them there isn't probably the best idea.
Yeah. So if we look at voice policies, we'll notice this one policy here is associated to two PSTN usages. We'll notice that the second policy is tied to three. From a PSTN usage perspective, we notice that it's tied to two routes, and off we go, where a usage may be used and tied to multiple routes. Routes may be tied to multiple usages, voice policies to multiple, and off. And this intermixing of however it makes sense for you to make this happen.
And if you're, this sort of speaks to what you might implement for a large company with many places, many locations, many physical exits and entrances to the environment from a PSTN perspective. Small, simple company probably wouldn't have these 45 routes and 33 PSTN usages and 12 voice policies.
Right. This is also how we accomplish least cost routing, right? Because we can say this route for this particular gateway can only dial numbers X, Y, and Z. So when you make the call, assuming that you have the usage that's tied to that route, that call will go out that particular usage. And so that's how we can control where numbers flow, not only what purpose is it, then there's your PSTN usage. You think of policies as what are your feature sets that you have on Lync calls? Do I have call forwarding? Do I have malicious call triggers? Do I have the ability to park a call? That's all of the, those are features that are enabled on your Lync calling client.
From a legacy perspective, legacy PBX perspective, that's where we'd call those, you know, your class of service. Right, whereas what we term a usage or a route is usually more your class of restriction. But in the Lync world, we combine the basis of all those things into that one thing called a voice policy. That voice policy assigned to that user really does determine both their class of service and their class of restriction.
Because of the PSTN usages and the routes that are tied to the voice policy. So it all goes back to when you're looking to say, how do I create from the GUI a PSTN usage and I can't? Well, it's because that PSTN usage is actually part of the route. Which is part of the voice policy.
You have to create it in the policy to get it to appear in the usage to tie it to the route.
And from a updates perspective, none of this has changed. So don't be worried if you're thinking, well, I don't understand what's changed. That's because nothing has. So this is exactly like it has been in Lync 2013. Okay. If we continue on, we look at the voice policies themselves. And the voice policies can be assigned per user, they can be signed per site, they can be signed at a global level. And none of that's changed. We still have the ability to say, if you are a member of this site, this voice policy applies, and very simplistic. To Aaron's point, if you're a small deployment, more than likely you have a voice policy, you have a voice route, and you have a voice PSTN usage. Trust your users, they can your route is star dot, and basically everything goes out this route if it's not internal. That works great for some companies. For others, whether it be large organizations, perhaps you are a university and you need certain restrictions, perhaps you have PRIs that cost money to call long distance, so you don't want everybody to make long distance type calls, on-premise only, non-on-premise, whatever the case may be, that's where the policies come into play. It's really about flexibility, and in 2013, one of the new features that we did get is the ability to assign different PSTN usages to call forwarding and to simultaneously ring. Prior in 2010, we only had the option to either you can or you can't. Now we can and only to these locations, and we'll get more into that. Common area phones, it was very common to have a kind of PSTN usage and route specifically for it, because perhaps this is the front lobby phone, and while that front lobby phone is available for users that come in and are waiting and want to talk to someone internal, we surely don't want them calling long distance on that phone. And so you can create policies specific for PSTN voice policies and tie them to routes, and off we go. So.
But again, nothing changed since RTM in that arena.
Perspective, yep. We get into PSTN usages, which are the class of service, right? Or the class of call. So the class of call itself can vary or not vary. By default, they add the internal local long distance usages in there. 99.9% of the time I delete them and name them what I want them to be, but that's up to you. It's conceptually what it is that idea, that perhaps you want somebody to have a class of a call that can go and be a cost to the company versus free to the company. That's what we have. And they don't do anything unless they're assigned to a voice policy and then have a route associated to them. So it all goes
They're just the glue. That PSTN usage really is just the glue that connects a voice policy to a route in the end.
Now, a voice route itself is how we figure out where do we go, right? So a route is tied to a number pattern, and it's also tied to a particular gateway, whatever mediation server we're going to use in gateway to go outbound. If we want that route to match a particular, or match everything, again, we can do a star dot and just say, go for it. You can do and go anywhere. We're all happy, and off we go. If we want it to be specific numbers, and it's not uncommon still to have PRIs that are your 800 PRIs, or your long distance PRIs, to have your local PRIs, and the 800 numbers have to go over the locals, and you know, however the configuration is from your phone system and whatever contracts you have, and this is where we have to define that. Well, so it could be the same rights that the user has, they just have different ways to get to that same number.
Right, right. And this is about sort of living in that legacy world. If you're still living in that legacy world of PRIs and trunks from your phone company, rather than you've moved to a SIP trunk and one, every number in the continental United States costs one amount for every user, there you make those different decisions. What I've often heard is, if every call costs the same, we have one route. As soon as one call costs a different amount than something else, we have two routes.
And which makes complete sense. If I don't care, it's like a cell phone is yep. today. And a lot of the in the US market is moving towards that model where everything's just a flat rate. So if I call next door or I call across the United States, it's the same amount, same cost of the call, then why complicate things? To restrict someone from calling long distance just for the sake of restricting them, perhaps, but otherwise there's no real reason. There's not a cost to the company to do so.
Exactly.
Right. Okay. Gateway preferences. Gateway preferences is where we conceptually have multiple trunks going to the same route. We can do this for a lot of reasons. We can do this because we want to have high availability. So we have perhaps multiple mediation servers all going to the same place, or multiple mediation servers kind of cross-connecting to multiple gateways. It's all the same route, but because they are an HA perspective, it can just round robin through it. Highly important, if you do add multiple routes to a single route, multiple gateways, then you are round robining. If you want to have a preference of order, you need to have single routes and then add PSTN usages to define the separates.
Right, and then those will, so in the multiple trunks in the same route, you've got that round robin mode. When you've got multiple trunks in multiple PSTN usages, it's a waterfall.
Right.
It tries one. If it fails, it'll try the next. It'll try the next until it gets one that succeeds.
And that's how conceptually you can have the same configuration for a user that says local, long distance, international. And if it'll try the local first, if it can't go out that trunk because the rules deny it, then it'll try national. It doesn't work because it's an international number. Assuming you have that usage, you're authorized. If you don't have that usage, or that voice policy doesn't have that usage, that voice policy is not authorized. And again, it's all about flexibility. You can create one configuration and just really mix and match this however it makes sense for you and your company. Again, just don't overcomplicate it for the sake of complication. So, okay. So that's all just a big rounding FYI. This is how it still works. Now we're going to get more into location-based routing. This was introduced in our cumulative updates and has been enhanced from a clienting perspective on what can and can't use client-based routing. What client-based routing is, in a nutshell, is restrictions based on what gateways you can use. Complete opposite of least-cost routing, which is where we'd want calls to go out the endpoint closest to the user if costs are different.
Endpoint closest to the far-end user.
The ending user, where we're going, right. So think of a North America company that has a European office as well, and they are calling a European location, it's very possible and likely that a call originating from the European office to a European location will be cheaper than making the call from their North America office transatlantic and making that call over that way, right? So what we would do is from a design perspective, is do exactly what we've talked about before, whereas we put in special routes and say these patterns, if you're dialing this, then go ahead and go out this particular gateway. And then you get both sides get a benefit from this. If you're in Europe making a North America call, you're going out the North America trunks. If it's a European call, out the European trunks you go. Everything's great. That sounds like a perfect world. Least cost, things are routing like you want to go.
So why would we want to have location-based routing?
So LBR, or location-based routing, is here for the fun purpose of introducing the ability to manage legislation in particular countries.
Right, regulatory compliance.
There are some countries that dictate that any call being made from their country must originate from a PSTN perspective from their country, and any call to their users within their country must go through their call.
And some of the regulations that exist in those other regions, in fact, govern it way down beyond that. They cover effectively they're preventing toll bypass, which is what we call least cost routing.
So, yep. And it's scoped specifically to users, specifically to, we'll see. There's a lot of scoping to do and a lot of configuration to do, but there's not only users and sites and gateways, and if you don't do all of it and then at the end don't flip it on, nothing works. But this in our latest updates, our latest cumulative update, goes all the way down to dial-in conferencing, where we can restrict, if it's a dial-in conference in a location-based routing restricted location, that users outside the region cannot call into this region. And it's all logical, and again, back to the regulatory requirements, and we have some nice flow diagrams to kind of add on to how this works and doesn't work. But July 2013 is where we brought this in, the second cumulative update, and in the latest October update, we enhanced it. So, least cost routing based versus location based. So we've talked about this a little, but the idea is, in a least cost routing configuration, you want the call to go out the gateway closest to the end party or the called party. You want to be able to make the least cost, the best route to that user with the least amount of cost. And if you've got the mediation there, why not?
And our assumption here is that network bandwidth is cheaper than a PSTN call.
Right. Well, and that's a great comment, because sometimes it's not, depending on where you're going to and from, and sometimes it doesn't make sense. It's not least cost. It may be you may be bypassing toll, technically, from a PSTN perspective, but it actually may cost you more.
If you're paying by the megabit.
Right. So you really need to plan accordingly.
When you're looking at, especially when you're looking at least cost routing versus location-based routing in some remote locations, you definitely want to sort of figure out your costs. Again, if the routes all had the same cost, we'd have one route.
Right.
In this case, we know that the route across the PSTN has X cost per call per minute, and we know that the route across the WAN has X cost per megabyte. And you really need to figure out what those mean in your environment to make the right decision.
It's also important, if from a WAN perspective, that's not a MPLS type connection, or maybe we're a VPN where we have no control over our QoSing, while it may be cheaper, the quality may not be acceptable. And so there's a lot of factors to come into. But yeah, that being said, that's least cost routing or the idea of toll bypass. Location-based routing, as we mentioned, is the exact opposite of that. It can't use the WAN as a route. We place, unless the WAN is all within the same location, then a country, then I guess.
That's not a WAN.
That's not, yeah. Anyway, and we have a route to the calling party that's closer, and we'll see a diagram here in just a second that shows how calls flow and what would be nice. So let's get into that so we can see this. So in a location-based routing scenario, this call can go either way, keep that in mind. So either the user in location A is calling out to the PSTN, or PSTN is calling into the user at location A. As the call's routed, they are associated to location A, and the call comes in a gateway that is part of location A. All's happy, all's good. And when we say PSTN, that's not location-based. That's PSTN. That's the big cloud of just phone numbers on the outside. So this doesn't matter if you are a North America number calling India, or if you're in India calling India. That number needs to go in through the gateway of location A, if the user is associated with the site that location A is associated with. Okay. Now, what would be bad is if the user's in a restricted country, location A, but they're traveling over to North America, to an office that happens to be in North America. A call comes in for them. It's the number, the DID, is owned by location A, by that gateway, and when it hits it, we have the ability in Lync to say, oh, the user is located over here, and let's go ahead and ring them. Well, the problem is that's not allowed by regulation. There's regulatory requirements that require that the call terminates the user in the same place that the actual PBX termination is.
Right. The idea is by us utilizing our WAN in the environment, we violated that toll bypass regulation.
We are, even in this case where we would not necessarily be costing, or they would not necessarily be losing money, it's part of it, it's just how it works. So it is what it is. So the Lync product has the ability to kind of control this. And again, it controls it down to the point where it controls it. So that can be a good thing and a bad thing. It's going to be good in that it meets the regulatory requirements. If this is not a regulatory requirement, more than likely this is a bad thing. And you need to define your routes and your PSTN usages rather than trying to use LBR to make this happen. Okay. So with location-based routing, because we're enforcing calls through a specific egress or ingress point for a particular user, that user's location is what matters. If the user's, which also means location has to be configured, but that subnet that they're in is defined as a part of a site, and that site is going to have a particular gateway. That gateway the call is going to either come in or out of. If the user's in the site, they're going to get the call. If they're out of the site and it's an inbound call, it goes straight to voicemail. Their phone never even rings. Mm-hmm. That also means they can't make the call back to the user because they can't go through that point. It prevents the incoming call to Lync. It prevents the outgoing call to an external number if the user's not in their location. But the key is location. It's location awareness. If the locations aren't defined right and the Lync user is in an unknown site, we block as well because we don't know where they're at. So once this is turned on, highly important that everything is configured correctly and tested. So dial-in conferencing for dial-out is the same thing. So if you have somebody in the dial-in conferencing that is either participating or is actually the attendant,
being called back,
the presenter or presenting of the meeting, you can't use, and they are in this restricted area, they can only call out of their particular mediation server. If, in fact, it has people that are in a different area and they try to dial in, they can be denied as well because they don't match the policies for how that particular PSTN call is happening. So it can restrict stuff. Now, you ask, where does this apply? How and what and where do I need to worry about that? You want to look this up and research it, but some of the countries, there's over 57 of them, include India. And really, when this was, and you'll see, it was designed specifically for India. This wasn't
India, the benchmark, effectively,
yes, highly restrictive area. So does this meet India's requirements? Yes. Is it designed for India? Mostly. Does it apply to everybody else that has these restrictions? As far as we know, yes, right now. But again, this is something you're going to want to research and see, does it apply to me? There are other ways to use LBR that can be a little bit more intuitive, and you can use the feature if you think about how we're restricting, and we see the call flows here in a second. But just be careful, because again, you can effectively deny calls if in fact you have it configured on stuff that doesn't need to be denied. Okay. Compliance and the limitations. So call park. So this is an interesting thing. So if you go to park your call and you are away and it's not a PSTN call, well, all of a sudden we can't go park a call where things don't exist. So you either don't have call park, you turn it off, or deploy it only where there's a single site so that it doesn't matter where you're at because there's only one location anyway and the call will always be parked in the correct location. For dial-in conferencing, like we mentioned, there is strict compliance. So you can't dial out if you are in a restricted zone to an unrestricted number route and vice versa. Nicely, we don't drop the calls, but this also means that your UM servers need to be located where your exchange servers are for those particular users because the call has to end in that location. So while the user may be traveling in North America and their servers are in India, that means their exchange servers have to be in India as well.
This is really getting down to the fact that to maintain strict compliance, you really do need to have your UM servers where the DIDs terminate in your environment for inbound calls.
And then finally, we have cumulative transfers where things can go through multiple hops and through session management, and that can work, assuming that everything it's going through is in the restricted zone. If any of those hops are back outside to something that's not part of our restricted and part of our call flow, that will be denied and restricted as would be expected, because the entire life of that call has to end up and remain in the site. And that's the easiest way to think about it. Okay, so how do we configure this? So if we're looking at the configuration of LBR, we look at it at site policies, voice policies, and trunks. And then the users themselves get it as well. So one or more subnet has to be assigned a location. If you have it enabled and you have no subnets defined in your locations, then everything is unknown. And if everything is unknown, then nothing's going to work as you would expect. Now, a lot of this may already exist, and so you're not going to need to worry about it because you've already got E911 in your environment, or you've decided you want to use media bypass and need to know your subnets that you're in. Or perhaps you just like to have people's locations pop up in the Lync client. Well, then you may already have these subnets there. So it's nothing new from a functionality or configuration within Lync. It's location. It just needs to be configured. From a voice routing perspective, there will be specific voice routes that are tagged as being location-based routes. And once they're tagged as a location-based route, they're location-based routes. Now, that's all done through PowerShell. But you can create the route either through PowerShell or through the GUI, but then you need to go flip it on to turn it into an LBR route. The location, the subnet, if it's not known, as we mentioned, then we are going to assume you are not where you're supposed to be, and we're going to block the call because we don't know if it's a valid call or not. All of the issues that come around with trying to know your location, if in fact you happen to be in office and one of them that's restricted happens to be a 192.168.1.x, and all the home users have that same thing because that's the default on those gateways, then you're going to have problems. So there may be a need to, if location-based routing is in fact new and defined, that those sites that are going to have location-based routing assigned to it may need to be resubnetted to make sure they're unique. They need to be 100%. So there's costs, there's advantages, there's disadvantages. And then, of course, the trunks. We have to say these particular trunks and mediation servers are the ones that can talk outbound from these restricted sites. And those have to be defined, too. And again, through PowerShell to create those trunk definitions. So the question will come, well, who can use this great feature? What's the combination, the secret sauce here that I need this to work?
The good thing to notice is there's really only one.
That's right. That's the nice thing is from a server perspective, we have one combination that works. From a client perspective, we have multiples. But from a server, it is you have to be at least cumulative update February 2013 on both your pool as well as your mediation server, or it's not going to work. It's as simple as that. So everything else is unsupported and doesn't work, and that's new code that's been added, and that's why. So if we look at what about our clients, well, who supports that? Well, we have a nice range of clients and a nice range of clients that do not, and in fact may require you to not utilize these particular clients in some regions.
Oh, sure. If you've got a regulatory compliance issue where you've got to support this in your environment, you may end up having to block client versions that aren't compliant.
Now, you'll notice a couple of things I find interesting. In Lync 2013, you have to have the matching or greater cumulative update, so that all came out at the same time. Lync 2010, you do not. Lync 2010, you simply work as long as you've got a Lync 2010 client. You'll also notice the same concept of Lync 2013. Mobile can't, but Lync 2010 can. Now, remember, Lync 2010 mobile was all dial back, so it's going to know if it can make the call or not make the call.
It's dial back on the rights of the user.
Right. Whereas 2013, no, because now we have voice over IP and we can violate things and we don't have any way to know your location, so therefore, without location-based knowledge, it's not going to work. Also, the new client, the App Store client for Windows 8, is not location-based aware, and neither are old clients. Imagine that. So OCS 2007R2, while it may work for everything else, it won't work for LBR.
It's good to see that Phone Edition is.
That is. That's right. So the latest and greatest updates work because, remember, Lync phone editions know where they're at, they get their location, they get their 911 location if required, and they have an IP because they're a physical device. So they're going to work just fine, as is the attendant console, if in fact you're using the 2010 attendant console. But the keys here are to just mobile 2013 no, and Windows Lync, the Windows 8 desktop client no for Lync for Windows 8. There we go. The Metro or client,
the modern client
that we have, yes. Okay. So how do we do this? How do we do this configuration? So in a high level steps to configure LBR, we need to create a voice policy that's going to be used specifically for LBR. So we're not going to be able to share this for non-LBR versus LBR because we're going to have a voice routing policy that has specific usages that are tied and routes to a restriction. So once we create it, and granted we can create, again, the voice policy through the web interface if we want, or we can make it through PowerShell. That's really up to you. But once you want to enable it, you'll notice we have this set, enable location-based routing, true or false, and then off it goes. Now all of a sudden, this particular voice policy is LBR enabled.
Right, for that site.
For that particular site, if you made a site-based one. Now, if you made a user-based policy, then you have a user-based LBR. And if you did this to your global, then you're going to only be LBR. And I'm not sure what the advantage of that is, because in theory, if you're all LBR, you're one site, then there's nothing.
Yeah. If you've got multiple offices.
Unless you're traveling.
Or you've got multiple offices with multiple link pools deployed across multiple sites in one of these restricted countries, you may, in fact, fall into that need.
Right. So it's a new object, it's a new configuration specifically for this LBR, and name them accordingly so it's obvious that when you're selecting this, you're putting a restriction on somebody. And then once that restriction has been placed, we're going to go ahead and do the same thing to a trunk. So we need to create a trunk either via PowerShell, or we can go ahead and create it through the GUI, and then we need to go ahead and set the configuration. When we set it, again, you'll notice the same concept of enable location-based routing restrictions are there, and we need to kind of throw that option on, and now that trunk is flagged as being a location-based route trunk. So we have a voice policy that's location-based, and we have a trunk that's location-based.
And they're both, I notice, bound to site IDs.
In this particular one, we did, yeah. The network site, and really from a trunk, you're going to be, because the mediation pool has a site ID associated with it, because it's bound to a particular site. And then in the network site, that you obviously have a network site, so it's a site ID. Yeah. Then, finally, we move forward to enabling LBR through the voice policy, kind of modifying. We've created the voice routing policy, we've created the voice trunk policy, and then we go to create the voice policy itself, and that we as well enable for LBR, right? So prevent toll bypass. Now, why didn't we use the same flag in all three? I don't know. But in this particular one, we call it toll bypass, and we want to prevent it. So if you flip it on to being true, then you're going to not make the most efficient route if you're not doing LBR. If you are doing LBR, that's what allows us to know that we're going to not use toll bypass. Then we go on to enable LBR globally if we want to create a trunk, which, again, we talked about. And off we go. So assuming that it was a site-based voice policy, not user-based, then that site is everybody, which is probably going to be what it is, then everybody in that site is now affected by the LBR policy. But when that happens, that means that that site is affected by the LBR policy. It's a site that you've changed, and you are potentially blocking calls that would be allowed otherwise by user policy. Now, so this is interesting that if you had a user policy, and you were in a site, you could effectively overwrite your LBR. So you need to watch for how configuration is set and make sure that we're not doing things. We're not breaking logic and rules because, again, user policies override site policies, override global policies. So it's the way it works. So you may have a site policy and you may think you're good, but if some users in that site have user policies and those aren't LBR enabled, well, then it's very possible you are bypassing toll. And then trunks that are LBR need to be assigned to a single site, because that's where, and to your point, where we point out the site ID, that has to be a single site saying this is owned by this particular trunk, which means if you had two sites that are geographically the same location, but you've broken them into two sites for manageability, for whatever reason that happens to be, you can't share those trunks across it. You'd have to have a mediation server and trunk in both sites that was restricted on both sides.
Right. When it comes down to it, really what it's trying to do is almost the same site ID match that media bypass does to determine if that call is going to route in that manner you expect it.
Yeah, and we'll actually see the logic. That's a perfect segue into now. So let's look at how this goes and flows and logic. And this can get, it's getting a logic discussion. So we'll notice that we have a starting point, and it's a nice and easy starting point, because if it's not LBR enabled, we just dump out. And it's good to go.
If globally, that global configuration, we have to turn LBR on. So it's really, That's that flow of, hey, I've turned LBR on, I'm testing it, I want to see if it works. If you didn't do that final step of turning LBR on globally, you're never going to see that call.
And again, that's the PowerShell command. So don't forget that once you've got everything configured, if you don't enable it, it's not going to work. Now, the other nice thing is if you do enable it and things go amok, well, as a great troubleshooting step, you can just flip it off, wait a couple of minutes, and then see if you fixed it, and it could very well be LBR. We'll actually look at an actual trace here in just a second, and that will potentially show you what you're looking for, too, to see if LBR is what is, in fact, preventing a call from happening. But since we're talking location-based routing, we're going to assume that we have enabled it, so we're going to go to the yes. Then we're going to go to look, is the user enabled for location-based routing? So that goes back to our site policy, our voice policy for the site. Is the user fall into that either with a user policy that has a restriction or a site-based policy that has a restriction? And if yes, we continue on the path. If no, then we go down to the usages in the policy of that user, and we can only route calls that are not location-based route enabled if they have multiple PSTN usages that have multiple routes. So while the first usage may be valid, because they're not location-based route enabled, that location gets kind of dumped from the logic of where we could go. That route is excluded. If in fact there are no routes that are not location-based routes and you have no PSTN usages, that call could fail too. So while you may not be location-based enabled, if your usage policies and your routes are not assigned appropriately to your voice policy, you may not have a valid route out. Okay? Assuming that we are, and voice policy is checked and off we're going, we go to the kind of double looking here. So it can be a loop where we go in the circle here, but is the call authorized by the user policy? Then no. Are there any additional ones that we could potentially look at usage policies? And that's where we go through the multiple usages, and that's normal usage policy, PSTN usage logic, right? Mm-hmm. Is it in the first one? No. What about the next one? What about the next one until we exhaust our PSTN usages? And once we find one that is LBR enabled and it matches this call, then we go to look, okay, now does any of those usages actually match our voice policy to an actual route we can use, and if so, we finally get to normal processing and out it goes. So there's a lot of logic that's finding two ways. If you're location-based routing enabled user, are there routes that you can use for location-based routing, and can you get out? And then on the converse side, if you're not location-based routing, are there routes you can use that are not location-based routing enabled? So it goes both ways. We're looking at both sides of the coin here, and making sure that you have a valid route to get out, and restricting if we cannot. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, if we're looking at how tracing and things work here, we'll notice, wow, this is a policy for authorization, and we have a policy for actual routing. So this logic of what we were just flowing through. So first we start with authorization, and we're going through, it's the routing request, and it's based on caller, whoever. So whoever's making the call is who we're going to be looking at. Their logic, right, for the specific policy. And we're going to look up what is their policy that they're using. In this case, it's the default policy. The phone route usage is an internal extensions, and so, hey, we can go out to an internal extension and off we're good to go. At least a route has to be available for where we're going, and it has to be able to get to that route. So now we're getting to the routing decision. So the call is authorized. And now we have to say, what particular route can we use for that particular outbound routing? And that routing decision is based off of the usage that is listed first, and then the route that's associated with that usage. And again, if everything matches up and everything's happy in the location-based routing restrictions, then off we're going. So authorization comes from your voice policy of the user. Routing from the voice routing policy that's assigned to the site dictates if it can actually route based off of that. So what about if we want to do trunk-to-trunk routing? Now we get some more complexion, right? Because now we say, well, let's go through it. So if we start here and we want to see, is the trunk you're starting off on as a LBR trunk? If yes, then now we go to the usages just like we did before, and then we look at the next applicable usage based off of that trunk and what usages are associated to that trunk. Assuming that we have something that the usage is our destinations that work in the same site, then we're good to go. So if on your trunk all you have are PSTN usages that also are associated with the site, so the same mediation gateways within a site, but they can be multiple gateways, but they're within the same site, the call is originated in the site, it's going to the same site from the restrictions, we're all good. If not, then we block. Now, what if it's a forward or simultaneous ring call. So if we look at the routes requested to forwarding simultaneous ring, off we go to use the usages of the user voice policy. Because again, in 2013, we can restrict someone's policies based off their usages that they have applied. This may or may not be different. It could be just whatever they're set to as their voice policy, or it could be specific usages that we want to specifically set for call forwarding and simultaneous ring. So once we decide to go through this route, we look to select the next applicable usage, just like we would on a normal trunk-to-trunk call, and then we look to say, okay, we're good to go, and the trunk is LBR enabled, yes, it's in the same site, yes, off we go. And again, we do the exact same block. If it's no, it's not, if there is no source trunk or destination trunk that's LBR enabled, either or, we're gonna go ahead and block the potential call. So we look in, and kind of a summary of trunk-to-trunk, we do evaluate where the call is started, where the call is trying to go, and is it allowed to get there if location-based routing is enabled. If not, then things aren't going to flow, which is what you want. The only scenario in which calls will ever use in this is when both trunks are in the same site, and that's the key. You can't forward, you can't simultaneously ring, you can't get out, you can't use trunk-to-trunk type routing unless all the trunks involved in this mix of call flow are within the same site. They're not, then you've violated the LBR and right. It's not going to flow.
Again, we're trying to maintain the sort of sanctity of the WAN, right? WAN shouldn't hold voice traffic in an LBR scenario.
Right. So in inbound routing, how does that work? Well, kind of the same way. So we don't lose restrictions from inbound as well. If a call comes in and the global's on again, it has to be on, and it's from a phone, so we know it's not a user, it's not a person that is not a phone. Is it a source trunk LBR?
Right, so when
yes.
We say is from phone, what do we mean by that? We really mean by that is the idea is it's coming from the PSTN, right? So we do this same evaluation both on an inbound call from another Lync user as an inbound call that's using mediation and PSTN resources.
That's right, because really all LBR has to do with is PSTN, and that's really what we're constructing. We're concerned about the telephone companies in these locations not being paid for
yep.
calls that should be flowing through them. That's what it comes down to. So if it's not a PSTN call, well, then it's not an issue. If it is a PSTN call from a phone, and from a PSTN phone is really, I guess, what we should say, then we check to see is it sourcing from is that call coming in, that PSTN call, onto an LBR-enabled trunk. If it is, then we have to see where its destination is. Now, what if you have a scenario where you have a desk phone in a restricted area, but you're traveling in a non-restricted area? Will your desk phone ring? Yes, that's an endpoint. We're looking at endpoints, we're
yep.
multi-endpointed, so
yep. no,
that's not a problem.
It's pretty interesting. You've got a physical desk in a physical location that has a CX600 or a some sort of Lync phone edition device. It's got an endpoint. It is signed in as you, it's got a point of presence. When an inbound call comes in and needs to be terminated, it'll try and ring both you and that phone. And if you're traveling out of sight and you don't have the same network site as where your inbound PSTN goes, your phone's gonna ring sitting at your desk and you will never know until you get the little thing that says you have an email.
Right, right. Your missed call either or your voicemail, whatever the case may be.
Yep.
And that's where we get down to this point, is the endpoint in the gateway site, right? That's endpoint, not user. Because the same thing could happen. You could have a desk phone in North America, but you're associated to this restricted site, then your desk phone's not going to ring, but you would ring. So either way, whatever endpoint exists in a site has a known subnet, the location's been verified, we're going to ring those particular ones if they're there. If there are none, route right to voicemail. We go to Exchange Unified Messaging. If it does have any of those points, we'll follow normal call patterns. We'll ring them. If they don't answer, they're going to ring to whatever they say to ring to. And off it goes. So the inbound routing is no different than outbound routing. The same restrictions apply across trunk to trunk and call forwarding. All of that happens all logically the same way. It's all got to be in one site. The easiest way to look at it is all calls, PSTN calls, originate, ingress and egress from that site, from any user associated to that site. There we go. Fun. So conferencing, how does that affect location-based routing? So the location-based routing conferencing updates that we just got applies and ensures that a single conference does not contain users from different sites from a dial-out perspective. So if you have a conference and the conference has knowledge to know who is in the conference and knows the location of the people in the conference, we're going to be able to determine, can a call be made from that conference out to a restricted number or not? So if you are making a conference in your site and you're including 15 people from that dial-in conference or that conference in general that are external to your location, and one that happens to be North America, North America won't be able to do a dial back on their PSTN. Could they join voice over IP to that conference? Sure, we're gonna allow that, but PSTN is where our restrictions happen. So that also means if we don't know who you are, you're unknown, there's a great chance you're gonna have a meeting that's not gonna work the way you'd expect it to work. And that's gonna happen with anonymous users. So anytime we have people that are in your conference that are outside the company, we're not gonna be able to have this mix of a location that way.
Right, it really gets down to what we're trying to adhere to in the conferencing is really the idea that we don't want to, again, bypass that carrier, and we don't want to bridge those two users or those groups of users together and violate that policy.
Yep, okay. So let's get into some scenarios of how this would look and how this would not work. So an incoming PSTN call. This is a great, pretty world of where we have a data center with all these Lync servers in it, and that's on our top here, and we have two sites. We have site one with three users, a PBX, and a gateway, and we have site two with users, a PBX, separate PBX, and a separate gateway, both obviously going to the PSTN cloud. So we also have a user that's out on the internet somewhere. They're in an unknown location, a site that's not defined. Somehow they're unknown. We don't know who or what they are. So, if we look at the way that the call is going to flow, a call from a PSTN comes in gateway one. The user is located in site one. It's using its gateway. So again, the boundary is the site. The gateway is tied to the site. The user is tied to the site. Therefore, the call succeeds. That's all happy-go-lucky. Then we have a PSTN call that the DID is tied to gateway one, which is in site one, but the user is currently in site two. That's going to be blocked. We're not going to allow that to happen because, why? The user is in a different site and can't share the gateway of a site that they're not a member, they're not currently part of. Same thing's going to be held true for an unknown location. Right? So we have a user that is either on the internet and ironically could be in the location and at home at a public hotspot, something of that nature. They can't use that PSTN gateway because we don't know what that site is, and so we fell on the safe side.
Effectively, if you're coming in across edge,
you're not
in an
work.
Unknown site.
Right. And so off we go, where the PSTN1 can handle calls to users in PSTN1 site, calls of users in site 2. PSTN1 cannot make calls to those users, whether they're known, unknown, whatever. Yeah, even though we are at the same location. Outgoing, how does that work? Well, conceptually the same way, where Lync user 2 is in site 1. He's making a call that is bound to be egressed via gateway in his site. Call goes happy-go-lucky, no issues. Now, from a least cost routing, which is what we'd be seeing here, Lync user 1 tries to use the gateway in site 2. That's going to be blocked. That's not going to happen. And this could be acceptable because he may then have a PSTN issue that is right in the row of the second one that is to his site in his gateway.
And
it's applied to multiple users in different combinations.
Yeah, right? And exactly. In this scenario, that Lync user one, he has those different capabilities and those different routes. His call is going to succeed, right? That's the power of this, right?
Right.
His call is going to succeed, but it's going to cost more money.
And that's all the telcos want. So it all works out for everybody that way. Okay. And then that's where we see the second route where, okay, we can't get out the PSTN usage, the primary you had, but we can go out the secondary, call will go out as expected. The user has no idea any of this is happening. It's not like we're playing, oops, can't make the call, let me try again, or there's any notification in the client. The call just succeeds through the authorized and provisioned routes. So it's all about routing. When we look at how routing happens versus authorization, does the user have the ability to get to this number or call this number? Yes, he is authorized. Does he have a route to get to that number? And in this case, he does because he can get to his second route, which is through Site 1's gateway. Okay, call forwarding from a graphical presentation. Look, we have the incoming call coming to Lync user 2. Lync user 2 just wants to send it to user 3, who's in his same site. And happily, that's not a problem, because he's all within the same site. Everything's contained. And in fact, that's just routing as it would normally happen. You'd expect it to happen. Now, a call comes for user 1, but he is forwarding his calls to Lync user 4. Uh-oh, that's not going to happen. Now, keep in mind, if Lync user 4 is traveling and in site 1 while he's making the call, that's going to work, because that's just a forwarded call, assuming that there's authorization,
yep.
As long as it's an endpoint that's within site. So it's all about where the endpoints exist within the site, location-based routing. I think that about covers location-based routing in a semi-high, low-depth perspective. So
yeah, it gets you to understand what the capabilities of the product are. It gets you to understand how you might implement it and what the pitfalls and sort of challenges are when you're implementing it.
So with that, let's go ahead and go on to this end-to-end routing, which we were talking before. End-to-end is an interesting idea of a name, but multiple-to-multiple is how I always communicate this, in that we can route a lot of things from a lot of things to a lot of things. So in OCS 2007 R2, those of us that used it back in those days were highly excited to have dial-in conferencing and voice and all these things that were part of R2. It was really great. But you had a lot of mediation servers because
and a lot of gateways.
And a lot of various gateways, because everything was one-to-one. One mediation server could talk to one gateway. So if you were doing, in the early stages, an IT SP or an internet service provider for your telephony, and they had a backup route, you either didn't have a backup route or you added another mediation server to make the secondary route. Or if you had gateways internally or PBXs. Or let's say you were a distributed with multiple MTPs throughout the organization. That's a lot of mediation servers to make this work.
Mediation server proliferation.
Yes. That was our OCS 2007 R2 story. I mean, it is what it is. That's how it was designed. When we got to Lync Server 2010, a lot of that was resolved because now a mediation server could talk to multiple things. Great concept, right? We can have a gateway A, we could have gateway B, and mediation server could talk to both. They could be a preferential order where it went to A first, then B, could be round robin. However you configured it to be, that was our Lync 2010 story. Our problem ran into where we wanted that gateway to talk to multiple mediation servers. So let's say you had a pool of three servers, of mediation servers, and you wanted each server to be able to have a route to the same internet service provider or PBX on-premise. Well, all of a sudden, now we're stuck. There were ways around it, as long as you weren't doing TLS. We could do fake names, host files, DNS records, blank stuff up. Got very messy, hard to manage, but you could get around it. TLS, there wasn't an option. You just couldn't do it because we couldn't go to the same name. Topology Builder would tell you so. You couldn't add it again to another location, to another mediation server. Now comes the world of Lync Server 2013. We now have the capability to have one mediation server talk to multiple pools, multiple gateways, and that another mediation server talk to those same gateways. And also have multiple gateways talk to, I mean, it still goes both ways. Right? We have this crisscross happening where we have one mediation server in this example on the diagram, where the middle one is shared by the two mediation servers, and they both have their dedicated, so it's almost like a backup route that they both share, but they each have a specific route. That's not a problem, and there's no configuration issues. So that's where we introduced the routing. Now, from a routing perspective, when we're looking at trunks and the inner networking of where things are going, in order to accomplish this, there was a breakup of the configuration within the Topology Builder. We had our trunks that represented the communications and the port we were going over, and we also had the gateways themselves, which were the single endpoint we were going to. So if you were only going one-to-one, then this doesn't really matter. You're just going to have a duplicate in your gateways and your trunks. You have to have one of each. You're going to have a gateway, and you have a single trunk on that gateway. However, on this particular diagram, when we have port A and port B both going to the same PBX, they just have different listening ports and sending ports that they're going to on the back-end side. And that way, we're able to differentiate the trunk traffic and keep two separate trunks up and functioning. Perfect. Everything works great. So each trunk's associated with its specific route. Each route has a specific trunk and configuration with specific port tied to the specific endpoint of that PBX or ITSP or whatever we're going to. That all works great. That's functioning. Now, how does this actually apply? In this particular instance, we have MTPs. And there's a vendor specifically that has some unique challenges with MTPs. And when we put media termination points, when we have them at a particular site because there are callers that are registering to that location, but we want them to use their particular calls from that trunk, that's where we get into the need to associate a specific IP from a site, from a media bypass perspective, in order to get them out the specific trunk with a specific port. That may sound like a lot, and it is, but it can all be done with the new end-to-end routing. So we can have a centrally managed PBX if we're still in a legacy mode, and we can have it have multiple termination points, and sometimes they're even within the same site where we have concepts of a virtual location that just is a break-off of that particular gateway. And we can get to it all via media bypass and use the same sites. We're not traversing things. We're using the way we'd want it to flow. And calls are working exactly like you'd expect them to work. Now, the one caveat we have is that when we have the termination points, we need to not only define the gateways, we need to define the alternate IP address. And the alternate IP address is not applicable if we don't have multiple sites we're going through. But if it is applicable, then that's all. You can associate the first one via the GUI through Topology Builder. And then, because every future one has to be done through PowerShell, and off you go to create these alternate IP addresses. It's interesting that there have been users that have wondered what this field has been, and it's been there forever.
Called the alternate media IP? It's been there since 2013, 2010 maybe.
And you break things if you put stuff in there, and that's not what you're trying to do. So the alternate IP is not an IP that's alternately we could go to. It's how we associate it with media bypass, who this is. So if you're not using media bypass, more than likely you don't care about this the alternate ID.
Right. The alternate IP and a mediation sort of gateway really got down to media resources in another place. It's the difference between call control and media flow.
Yep. Okay. So here we have the alternate media IP. The first trunks gets its configuration done, and then when we go to add additional trunks, it's all done via PowerShell. We add additional ports that we're going to listen to. We have the representative media IP for those trunks to define within PowerShell, which is the reflexive of the alternate media IP that we have in the GUI for the primary one, but it's because we want to make you think, we go ahead and add a representative media IP in the GUI or through PowerShell. And so anyway, that's all configured. And as you see on the diagram, trunk 2 is using the media termination point 2. And he is talking appropriately over port 5061 to it to get to it. The same mediation server, when he wants to talk to MTP1, while he's going to the same destination IP, he's going to a different port. He's going to 5060. And when he hits 5060, that's for MTP1 instead of MTP2. And so it all works.
Same signaling IP. Same signaling. Again, that control is still maintained through the same channels.
That's right.
It's just the media flows and allows that bypass.
Right. And because otherwise, if you think about it, when we were doing our media bypass, we wouldn't know where we were, and we'd be assuming we weren't where we thought we were. Media bypass wouldn't work because media bypass is only going to work if we're in the same site.
Yeah.
If we're not on the same site, then it doesn't know where we're at, and so it's not going through. So that's what it brings out to us. It brings out the real world of a vendor that really proliferated this concept, and we support it. So it all works just fine.
Yep. It was this scenario of them having sort of one call control channel in a central location and lots of media control channels in those media endpoints in those other locations.
Right. Yep. Okay. So off we go. Now, what about using this from a resilience perspective? So like we saw in the initial diagrams, the top and bottom mediation servers were talking to a different gateway, and then they were both talking to a single gateway, so they were sharing a gateway. Well, here we don't necessarily have to have a third gateway that is optional. In this scenario, we're using mediation server C is talking to gateway F. We have a lot of using FQD and N, and then from port A to port B, and then mediation D is talking to gateway G over C and E. But then maybe mediation D also wants our route to use gateway F as well. Well, that's not a problem. We're going to use our port C, which we already had, going to his port B, and everything just works just fine.
And again, it's that trunk is that tie between our port that our being the mediation server and their port being the gateway, it's that bridge. And those bridges must be unique, but because we still maintain that uniqueness in these, we don't have to add any additional ports on those gateways to make this scenario work.
Right. And nicely, it's a combination. It's a cumulative kind of structure, I guess, if you would, of it's the destination IP and his port, your IP and your port. Those are what have to be unique, and that's what we're looking at. We can't have the same port IP combination going to multiple things, because then we wouldn't know what goes when and where. But as long as it's unique for that particular gateway, then we're good to go.
Yep.
Yeah, because otherwise, how would the gateway know where to go? Okay. Trunks and gateways. So separations of the gateways and trunks means a little bit of confusion for you if you don't need it. But assuming you do need it, it means that we can kind of have a resiliency within the routing logic itself as well. We have the ability to define gateways, servers, mediation servers, how they all logically play together, and we have the ability to kind of figure out how inbound and outbound can go to various locations, all based off of a single outbound SBC. So yeah. In this case, we have Site 1 and Site 2. Both are using the same SBC, but that's for for whatever reason it happens to be. You have your choice of because you want mediation to terminate at your location, you want it to go across the WAN, but you want to use an SBC that's external to your environment.
Yeah, maybe in fact you could also do the same scenario with multiple SBCs in each of these locations, but those SBCs terminate into the same MPLS cloud for your ITSP.
Yeah, and that's where I personally found a lot of it is the ITSP world, because having your own SBC out, not on-premise and in the cloud, is probably not going to happen. But if the SBC is the cloud SBC, the ITSP, well, then that makes sense. Okay, so now we get into routing from a trunk level perspective. Where is this done? How is this done? Now, on the right, you'll notice that we have a 2010 site and PSTN gateways and trunks are expanded. On the 2013
okay.
site. And we've expanded it. Now, if we're a 2010 site, it's not going to look the same because we don't have the same configuration for obvious reasons. So in a 2013 world, we have gateways and we have trunks. Now, you'll notice in the bottom, site 2, he's got gateway 1, 2, and 3. He's got trunks 1, 2, and 3. He's a 1-to-1. He's just simply, for every gateway he has, you're going to have a trunk. Otherwise, you wouldn't have a gateway, right? So it has its basic configuration. It's tied to particular trunks, which are tied to particular listening ports and then mediation server ports. That all makes sense. That's like you would expect and has been in 2010. Up in Site 1, we have the PSTN gateway A, who has his trunk to A, but he also has a trunk to Media 01 Gateway 1, something completely different. It's a gateway that they've got. And off it goes for a specific trunk to that.
Sure. He's named that trunk Mediation 01 to Gateway 01, maybe talking down to that other site, that other trunk in that other site.
Yeah, very well could be. It's really the concept being you have, in this area, Lync Site 1 has a single gateway but has multiple trunks. In Lync Site 2, they have a 1-to-1 like it was today. And that's, again, kind of visually showing what we just talked about. So that's all good. So it helps with media bypass. It helps with high availability and expandability. And it also helps with having a consistent list of trunks and configuration in the same area. You're not making stuff up to make it work. It
sure.
just works.
And right, again, it fully supports TLS.
Yes, yes.
Since and which you are really using FQDNs around the world and you aren't sort of faking things out and creating listeners on those other gateways and those other media termination points.
Yep. Okay. So that's what we have on routing. Now, when we move into session management, we've talked a bit about this trunk-to-trunk concept. It was always a big sticking point with 2010 in that we could never have Lync at the front of a PBX replacement or integration.
Or the center of that.
Or yeah, that any way to be the man to decide where calls go.
So it had to be a far end point on another branch making a decision.
So we could there were multiple ways to accomplish this. We could put a session border controller in front and then it do the logic of routing, what goes to Lync, what goes to the other stuff. He could be at the tail end where the PBX decided it's not on my end, therefore it's going to the Lync world. but we could never be the guy that said, all calls come to me and I figure out where they go. Session management is what corrects that. And there's controls around this. So we're not necessarily restricting ourselves to saying, if a call comes in, then it's not on our site, out it goes. When in fact, based off the same concepts of PSTN usages, we can say a call that comes in our trunk can go out a specific trunk as well. And so globally, we can set restrictions on inbound, outbound trunk usages, where things go. That's session management. So the idea was to give flexibility to the Lync implementation. So it may still be that you want a session board or controller to handle what goes to Lync and doesn't. Maybe you don't want to overload Lync to make it think about stuff that isn't bound for Lync. And you want that SBC, but you don't have to. Before you had to. So when the call comes in, think of it as a logic flow of the call coming into Lync. When it comes into Lync, he goes through his little diagrams that we went through of, is it somebody internal? No. So if it was an inbound call, it's not bound for any number or any DID or non-DID or any object that exists in the Lync world. Then the very last step is I look at my trunk that I came in on and say, do I have an option to go out this trunk?
Or
out a different trunk. And if this I do have the right to go out these trunks, it's based off the PSTN usages assigned to that trunk and assigned to the user. So if they come in, do I have the right to use another trunk to go back out the system? So think of it as a call coming inbound. It hits your Lync system. It's looking for a DID on your Lync system. You don't have it. It's not in the vacant. It's nothing that you own. But it could very well be your legacy PBX that you're fronting with Lync. And so it matches the pattern. It's valid. So the patterns go out the route, and off it goes through a different trunk to the alternate system. It could also be the same trunk. So it is possible to get a route in, and we've done this forever, where a route, think simultaneous ring, trunk to trunk is what we're doing. Call comes in back to back, so then makes another call right back out that same trunk to make the call to the external user if it's an external PSTN number. This is the same concept, but it's a trunk that you own, and it doesn't have to originate on the trunk it came in on, and it doesn't have to be sim ring or call forwarding.
Yeah, this was a scenario I've seen at a couple of customers now where we took inbound calls and we wanted to transfer those back outside of the company, effectively redirection at the gateway layer. And definitely in 2010, that was a challenge that's solved in 2013.
Right. Yeah, and really creates the fix for what a lot of people would say is just a basic functionality of a PBX. Mm-hmm. And again, that's where 2013 is a full functioning PBX. So here's a sample scenario. We have routing of an IP PBX call to a PSTN gateway from Lync, comes in the trunk. The trunk that's associated to it, we realize is another PBX, and we can route directly to it, route the outgoing trunk. We don't need to do anything. It can just bypass Lync. Comes in one, goes out the other, off we go. We also have the scenario where there's a completely different PBX, and the routing of the IP PBX call to another PBX comes in via Lync, and once it hits Lync, we have the ability to then route the logic. So inbound trunk, PSTN usage, we realize that it's not our call, and we just send it right over. And if media bypass is possible, all of this can happen in a nice flowing Lync's not involved in anything but session management at this point. Mm-hmm. So we're still controlling the call, but we're not actually dealing with the call.
Right.
We're not transcoding. Right. So it makes it a very nice, clean solution for us. We support the association of multiple PSTN usages like we would expect. It allows the ability to say, while you come in one, there could be multiple routes, multiple places you want it to go. Maybe you can come in on a trunk and you can go out to an external number. You can also go to one of multiple PBXs, all based off your routing patterns. All of that's logical within the trunks.
Yeah, this makes sense in some legacy PBX scenarios where you've got maybe different cost PRIs coming in and coming in through certain gateways, or you've got different cost models coming in. Maybe your 800 numbers come in over a specific inbound trunk, and only those 800 numbers should be able to exit back out the system. You've got these flexibilities to be able to control it.
Right. The key being that the configuration for what manages your PSTN usages, your dial plans, your voice policies, all of that's still tying in together. So as things are coming in for a user and routing out for a particular user, and the way the system is defined from a global and a infrastructure perspective is all still managed within those usages and routes. So None of that's changed. And that's where we look at configuring. How do we set this up? Well, if we had a new route, we could do this via, again, PowerShell or the GUI. But if we had a new route that we were creating, a voice route, we could then tie that route to a trunk, and that trunk could have multiple usages associated to it. And so not only do voice policies have PSTN usages, but the trunks themselves can have PSTN usages. And
right,
in the GUI, you can see that.
That's the new thing.
And that's really the glue that allows it to come in and go right back out. So a lot of people have asked when they're setting up trunks, what is this PSTN usage and what does it mean to me? Well, if you're not doing session management or trunk to trunk, nothing. It means nothing to you. And if you put something in here and nothing will ever route back out, it doesn't really matter. It's an authorization is what we're adding here on the trunk level. And that's all defined in the GUI under the associated PSTN usages. You simply select the usage and the routes and off we go. Or again, via PowerShell if that's your fancy. So there is a Lync 2014 conference coming up very soon. It's going to be in February. Yes, Las Vegas, Nevada. As we were just talking, we expect it to be nice, cool evenings, decent days. It should be a very nice time. That's coming up February 18th to the 20th. You can register at linkconf.com. Seats do fill up quickly. There aren't many. Last year was pretty packed, and that's probably an understatement. So a lot of new and great information. So hope to see you all there. And with that, we thank you. Not that, but with that, we thank you for going ahead and spending your time with us today. Thanks so much.